2 Corinthians chapter 5 this morning and at verse 17 to be very particular on where we are. Paul has been sharing with us his burden. Paul, in this 1 and 2 Corinthians, are probably some of the most personal letters that Paul writes. And in them, he details his struggle. It's not easy, in case you haven't guessed it yet, it is not easy being a Christian. But to compound matters, it's even harder to be a Christian serving God. To serve the Lord Jesus Christ comes at a price. And Paul has reminded us of that price that he paid. He said, listen, others may not count me a disciple or an apostle, but let me tell you what I did for Jesus Christ and what it cost me. And you remember how he enumerated to us how he had been beaten 3 or 4 times by the Jews and by the Romans. How he had been falsely imprisoned. All of this, he said, because I was preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hey, I'm preaching the gospel, and guess what? They stone me and throw me for dead in the city dump. Hey, I'm preaching the gospel, and guess what? God says, I want you to go take this here ship and go on a voyage over there and preach to them people too. I get in the middle of the sea, and guess what? The ship is wrecked, and we nearly drowned. Hey, I spent a night and a day in the deep. I'm telling you, I know a little bit about suffering for Jesus Christ. That's the story of 2 Corinthians. What it could cost, what it might cost, and what we ought to be willing to pay. And so you say to yourself, well, who would want to live a Christian life if it's that bad? And of course, last week as we took a look at it, Paul said, yeah, it's rough. But I'd rather be doing this than anything else. I could have made my living as a tent maker. I could have been a happy man over there persecuting Christians. I could have been very, very comfortable receiving the glory of men because they looked up to me as a Pharisee. I looked down at them and they looked up to me. And it was a very comfortable life for me. Not so much for the Christians I was persecuting, but hey, it wasn't a half bad life for me. I was well paid, well liked. And he gave up all of that well stuff for Christianity. And when he becomes a Christian, he doesn't speak about his body, his physical life being that well anymore, but he does talk about his soul. And as the song goes, it is well with my soul. And when it's well with your soul, it's well with everything else. And so Paul then is sharing with us his difficulty. He begins to share with me. Now, the central theme of Paul's life is the cross. To people who are born again, to those of us who hear this for the first time and get it, it's revolutionary. Paul had religion. He had it for years. He had it from the time he was growing up as a child. His mother would teach to him the Shema, "Behold, O Israel, our Lord is one God." And from the time he could hear, his mother was whispering that into his ear. He had religion his entire life. We meet him somewhere around the age of 40 or so, near about. And he's there standing there stoning Stephen, holding the jackets so that those could pitch a better one at Stephen as they stone him to death. He grew up in religion. He was a religious fanatic. But something happened to him. The cross that he persecuted, the Christ who died on the cross, who was his enemy, suddenly became his Savior. Lord, what would you have me to do? He said one day on the Damascus Road. And God said, I'll tell you what, you're going to take my name to kings. You're going to take my name all the way to Rome. I'm going to have you preach in the very palace of the emperor. My goodness. Wow. The cross is the death of Christ. But the death of Christ is just the beginning. He had to die. That's the first thing that we read when we read of Jesus on the road to Emmaus with his disciples. And you notice it says, and he began to teach them all that Christ must suffer, that he must die. Because without the death of Christ, there could be no resurrection of Jesus Christ. And without the resurrection of Jesus Christ, there could be no new life for you and for me. So the whole theme of Paul's life is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Paul has a phrase that he loves to use. In Christ. You see that over here? In Christ. Paul uses this phrase 54 times in his writings. It's used a total of 55 times in the New Testament. Once it's used by Peter himself in his benediction there in the letter of Peter, 2 Peter. He uses this term in Christ. But Paul uses it 54 times. In Christ. Everything in Paul's life is centered in this action. The death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So he says to you and to me, wherefore? Now this wherefore, you have to, when somebody, these guys tell us in college, when you see a wherefore, you're supposed to find out what it's there for. Because this wherefore relates to whatever he said, his argument that he made in the beginning. Whatever that argument was, this verse is tied into it. And what is Paul talking about in the first chapter? The death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the change it makes in us. Since Jesus died, since he was buried, since he rose from the dead, since that is our belief, since that is the thing that we hold to as the gospel, wherefore, if any man is in Christ, there is a new creation. A new creation. Paul wanted you and I to know a thing or two. See, God is not in the habit of patchwork Christianity. He isn't here to take a look at my life and say, well, you know what, this is good and this is bad and I'll fix the bad and I'll tweak this and I'll... No. I am corrupt. I was, as David said, in sin did my mother conceive me. I come from a long generation of sinners. God has declared that in me there is no good thing. For all have sinned, all of us completely have sinned. So that there is no good thing found in us when God examines you. God doesn't look down and see any good at all. No redeeming quality in man at all. See, we all look for some redeeming quality in us. There was a discussion at work the other day. One of the guys had a problem with Jesus and his forgiveness. It seemed to him that Jesus was just a little too forgiving. And he couldn't see how Jesus could forgive a murderer. How Jesus could forgive this type of person or that type of person. Jesus should just forgive good people. That was his argument. I said, you're going to go to hell just because some bad people got saved. But this is the mind of man. We look and we judge one another. And we judge everybody based on us. I'll wager that anything he does is not considered bad. At least not as bad as that guy. But when God looks at you and when God looks at me, when he looks at us, apart from Jesus Christ, he sees no good thing. No good thing. For all have completely sinned and come short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one, not even a little bit righteous with God. So God had to do something radical. Since he couldn't save the old me, guess what he did according to Paul? He nailed me to the cross with Christ. You and I have been nailed to the cross with Christ. We have been bought with a price. We are no longer our own, for we have been sentenced with Christ to death. We have been nailed to that cross. And since I have died with Christ, yet I live, but not really me. Christ, Paul says, lives in me. And if that be true, then if I am in Christ, I'm a new creation. There is in me a totally new man. Not like the old. Completely new. The old man is physical. The old man is earthly. The new man is spiritual. I have been born of my parents, but now I have been born from God. I have been born of the Spirit. The Spirit which in me, which was dead, remember? My spirit, which God gave to me, was completely dead. And through the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, my spirit is resurrected and I have been made alive, so that now within me there is this spiritual man longing to go home, but this physical man keeping him tied to this old world. And until this physical man wears out and falls down, this new man cannot continue his journey home. So I am held prisoner and captive in this body. I want to be there, but I'm stuck here. Someday we shall be released and we shall be at home with heaven. We shall be home with our Father. We shall be home with Jesus Christ forever, reigning and ruling and reigning with him. But in the meantime, we are here. This phrase then, in Christ, in, that's where new life begins. You know, sometimes people talk about turning over a new leaf. And they try. Every year people make on New Year's, people will make a New Year's resolution. You know how long New Year's resolutions last? It's expected that the longest of them lasts maybe 2 weeks. People start off with a good New Year's resolution, and boy, that morning they're going to get up and they're going to keep that resolution. And then by a couple of days, most of us by the third day have given up on the resolution. Good people, determined people, might stick with it for a couple of weeks, maybe even a couple of months. But by February, most of the New Year's resolutions have all gone. People get that bike out. They're going to ride that bike. And the next thing you know, it's in a garage sale somewhere or a yard sale. They're selling it off. Why? Because they have abandoned that. See, people want to put on this new leaf. But the problem is the one that Jesus told us about. You can't put new wine into old wineskins. Because when they begin the process of fermentation and the gases of fermentation expand, guess what happens? The old bag bursts. So you have to put new wine into new skins so that both are preserved, we're told. And that's the problem. God could not put his Holy Spirit into me. He had to create in Christ a new man. There had to be a new creation. There had to be a new me that could hold this new spirit. Because the old was dead. The old was corrupt. The old was failing. And so God created a whole new person. This new me. Yeah, it kind of looks the same. I mean, I got up the next morning and I didn't look any different. Looked in the mirror and combing my hair, I was the same guy I was the day before. But there was something new happening inside of me. All of a sudden, Jesus Christ took up residence within me and began to work in me. This process of change. And he works. And his Holy Spirit works and works and works and is in the process of changing me into Jesus Christ. But he couldn't do it with the old. He had to do it with the new. Because the old couldn't hold it. The old would burst. So he had to come up with this new. And where does he place it? He placed me in Christ. In Christ, I am a new man. Not in me. In me is just the same old stuff. And every now and then when I fall back into the old man, you'll know the old stuff is still there. Right? You get my temper going, you'll see the old me pretty fast. But in Christ, in him, I'm a new person. I have been baptized into Christ. And so long as I stay in Christ, I'm in good shape. But when that old me, that old corrupted me, then I go back to my old ways. Jesus is the change. He is the catalyst. He is the new that you and I are supposed to be. Not in religion. Paul had religion. What changed Paul? The message of the cross. When Paul said, Lord, what will you have me to do? When Paul recognized that Jesus Christ was not just a man who died, but he was the man who died and was buried. Paul knew all along that Jesus died and was buried, but he believed that Jesus died and stayed there. They just couldn't find his body because, hey, I heard that his disciples came by and stole it. That's the rumor. That's what they paid the Roman soldiers to say. And if it comes to the governor's ears, don't worry, we'll buy you out. We'll get your freedom. But suddenly things are different, though. Because that Jesus that Paul knew was dead, that Jesus that Paul knew was in the grave, suddenly was talking to him on the road to Damascus. And suddenly Jesus who was dead was alive. And the living Christ changed Paul. And Paul became new, not in thought, not in turning over a new leaf, not in becoming more religious, but by meeting Jesus Christ. In Christ. See, here's the thing. You have got to know him. Paul, when he first discovered Jesus Christ, we're told, he went off to Arabia and spent time by himself so he could learn of Jesus Christ. He didn't want to be influenced by those around him. He wanted to know Jesus Christ. He wanted to know him in a very personal way. And so Paul spent time alone with Jesus Christ. And until we do that, until we make the gospel story part of our life, I tell you all the time, it's great that we read the whole Bible. It's great that we read the entire New Testament, but it is essential that you spend every day in the Gospels, because that's not where Jesus is talked about, but that's where he's shown and demonstrated. I get in my car in the morning, I start my car up, and boom, Gospel of John. On the way home, I've got the Gospel of Luke. And because I'm driving, I get the dramatized story, where you can hear the multiple voices. That way I can sort of place myself there and keeps me a little bit more alert, because when the voices are changing, it catches your attention. When you read the Bible just monotonally, you can get lost easy when you're driving where you're at. But by having these voices change, it keeps me in the picture. Because suddenly I hear the narrator, then I hear Jesus, then I hear Peter, then I hear somebody else, and I hear somebody else, and it keeps me alert. And so every day I am spending my time, 45 minutes in the morning, 45 in the afternoon, that's 90 minutes a day that I spend with Jesus Christ in my car. 90 minutes every day. Then I get to read the book of Corinthians so that I can be ready for you on Sunday, right? But every day I'm going through the life of Jesus Christ. Every day I am going through the gospel story. Every day I am walking and talking and driving with Jesus and hearing what it is that he had to say. Why? Because I want to know him better. Why? Because I want to be in Christ. You can't be in him unless you can get into his mind. Until you can think the way he thinks, know what he's thinking and acting upon, and what it is he's trying to develop in you. That's the important part. I know the death, the burial, the resurrection, but that's just the beginning. I want to know the man. I want to be in Christ. Wherefore, if any man is in Christ, then he's a new creation. Old have passed away. Part of our life, we have trouble with the old passing away because we don't spend that much time in Christ. In Christ, then the old passes away. We're too much like the old because we don't spend enough time with Jesus. And the only way you really spend time with Jesus is, as I said, in the gospel stories. So this new creation that is, first of all, in Christ, takes place in two parts. First of all, it happens in Christ. It happens because I believe the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. I believe he's alive. Dead people don't change anything or anybody. Living people do. It was so important that Jesus got this concept across. It's so important that's why in the beginning he says, when he's talking about them and he's talking to the Jewish people, he said, God is the God of the living. Everybody was talking, well, Abraham is dead. Our forefathers are dead. Isaac is dead. Jacob is dead. The prophets are dead. And Jesus said, whoa, hold on there. God is not the God of the dead, but of the living. God is a living God who spends his time with living people. My mother is not dead. My mother is more alive than I am because she is in eternal life. She is in the very house of God even today. She is beholding the face of our Savior. She is looking at the glory of God enthroned there in heaven. That's real life. She looks maybe our direction, says, oh, poor old Terry, still stuck in that old body. Can't come home just yet. We think we're alive and we have fallen for the lie. We're like those Jews. Our ancestors are all dead. No, Abraham is not dead. He's just not with you. Well, if he's not with me, then he must be dead. Oh, really? There's a lot of people who aren't with me. They're very much alive. God is the God of the living. We get heartbroken because we see people, we look at their lifeless body and we think they're dead. We say, oh, she's dead. Oh, he's dead. And the truth of the matter is, they're not. I was alive when I was in my mother's womb. But life didn't really start for me until I came out. As a developing body, I was very comfortable in there. It was warm, it was protected. I probably didn't want to come out. That's why babies come out kicking and they whack them, they start screaming. That's why children are so naturally gifted towards swimming. You throw a newborn in the water, boom, he's comfortable there. He's not used to this life here on dry land. Not used to this life where he's got to get used to walking and talking and defending for himself. He liked it when he didn't have to do anything but just lay there and mama fed him and did everything for him. Breathed for him. Everything was taken care of for you. Now, we don't feel sorry for that baby who's in mama's womb. Oh, we sit there, we touch it. We say, oh, how far along? And we get all excited. We're waiting for him to come out. We're not saying, oh, we're waiting for him to be born, to be birthed. We're not waiting for him to live. He's already alive. We're just waiting for him to enter into this world. And we talk about death, but really it's just people on the other side of heaven are watching our birth and waiting for us to be birthed into a new life, which we find in Christ, which changes us. When Christ is in us, suddenly it does two things. First, there's an internal change in me. It changes what I am and who I am and what I want to be. Paul, who wanted to persecute Christ, suddenly wanted to tell the world about Jesus. What a huge radical change in him. There was this internal, when Jesus Christ comes alive in us, when we are in him, there's an internal change in us. Our wants, our desires are changed. I no longer look for money and fame and fortune. I look to bring to Jesus Christ honor and glory. That's it. This internal change in me is an internal change. It changes who I am at my very core. It changes what I want and what I want to do. How I want it is changed. All of these things have become new because I'm in Christ. It's a huge, huge change in me that takes place. A huge change that takes place because Jesus has done something in my life. So I am changed. From the inside, I am changed to the outside. And so we sit there and we look over and over. People. Paul was changed. Priscilla and Aquila changed. There's a lot of people that we read about in the Bible who used to be different kinds of people. That Philippian jailer who earlier was beating Paul and then all of a sudden now is caring for him. This jailer who had housed Paul in the prison suddenly has Paul up in his house with his children and he's baptizing them in the middle of the night. This jailer who once enslaved Paul now suddenly is honoring Paul. Why? Because he too learned the story. He learned of Jesus Christ. He learned it through Paul, who once cast people into prison. Paul now finds himself in prison. One of the things this fellow was saying to me yesterday, I said, well, you know, God doesn't let anybody get away with anything. Paul was the worst of Christians. He was the worst person to the church. So guess who had the roughest life? Paul did. He had to pay for his sins in this life. God, even, you know, you're done with your sins, sin's not done with you, and you have to. God has his rule of reciprocity where you have to pay for what you did. And since Paul had beaten the church, Paul was beaten. Since Paul had imprisoned Christianity, Paul finds himself in prison. Because Paul was the source of hardship in many people's lives, Paul found his own life a hardship. But he realized, now I could bring glory to God through this difficulty, through this hardship. I am now sacrificing and serving Jesus Christ. Instead of having people serve me, I am now serving the Lord. When a person truly comes to Christ, he finds that what he had done, didn't ask God, please, Lord, don't make me suffer for any of the bad that I have done. Now that I am a Christian, I shouldn't have to suffer. No, he said, Lord, I understand that what I did was wrong. And I understand there's a payment for it. And I accept that payment at your gracious hand. But God used all of that repayment to bring more glory to Jesus Christ. So that by the time Paul's life is over, the gospel is spread from Jerusalem all the way around North Africa, all the way around Europe, clear over into Britain in the life of Paul. Paul spread the gospel far and wide because he had such a debt to the church. So Paul, this inward change, this Spirit of Christ changing him, but then not only is there an inward change in us, our desires are changed, our wants, our goals. No longer my honor, no longer my, but we find ourselves saying to him, to God be the glory. God needs to, as John would say, he needs to increase and I need to decrease. I don't mind that people see and hear more of Jesus and less of me. That's the way it's supposed to go. But finally, there's also not only this new creation within us, while we're in Christ, but there's also a new creation outside. We look at our outside world, we looked at our surroundings, and they too are different. There is a new creation. This new creation is demanded by the fact that I'm in Christ. How can I be the same person I was before when Christ is living in me? How can I be the same man I used to be when I am now found in Christ? Since I am the body of Jesus Christ, what should I be doing except the things that the body of Christ would do? How would the body of Christ behave itself? Is Christ's body behaved differently than my own? Is it drawn by different things than mine is? Then I should begin to be changed like that. It's not possible I'm in the old man. Because in this world, my eyes see the same things yours do. I'm attracted to the things of this world by the body that everybody else is attracted to. It is that ability, though, for Jesus Christ to put us in him and let us for a while see through his eyes, hear his heart beating in our ears, to develop the mind of Christ. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ. You have to let it be there. Problem is, it's easy for us to resist it because the mind of Christ is so different from our own. It wants different things, and they're foreign things to us. They want the glory and the honor of God. What did Jesus always say? I'm not here to glorify myself. I am here to do what the Father told me to do, the way the Father told me to do it. I'm here to say what the Father told me to say, and to say it the way the Father told me to say them. Jesus Christ had no will of his own. As the Father works, I work. The Father gives life, I give life. I am doing what the Father showed me to do. And he constantly puts himself, although he is equal with the Father, although these three be one, yet Jesus Christ in this life subjugated himself totally to the will of the Father and constantly was saying to the people, hey, when his mother came to him and said, son, they're out of wine. Jesus didn't immediately go over and make wine. He said to his mother, my time has not yet come. My Father has not yet told me that I can do that. Oh, granted, he is probably going to give me permission to do it, but he hasn't given me permission yet. And I can't do it until I get permission from my Father to do it. See how he was subject? And let this mind be in you, which was also in. I can't do that yet, because I haven't been given the permission to do it. Once the Father tells me to do it, see, I will do what the Father tells me to do, and I will do it. This is the secret. I will do it the way he tells me to do it. People like going to church, so long as they can go to church their way. People like preaching in church, so long as they can preach it their way. It's when you have to limit yourself to what God is willing to allow you to do that makes it tough, makes it difficult. Then all of a sudden, like Jesus, who lost large parts of his crowd, when he said to them, you must eat my flesh and drink my blood, everybody said, I'm out of here. It's not easy to do things God's way because we want to do it our way. We have to be in Christ. We have to be that new creature or it doesn't work. If I am not a new creation and I'm still the same old creation, I cannot in this flesh. It is impossible to please God. But once I'm in Christ, and once Christ comes in me, then the internal man begins to change, and as the inside man begins to change, there also seems to be some change on the outside. This new creation gives to me a new standing before God. I am now his son. This new creation brought with it sonship. I am the son of God. You are the children of your Father, Jesus would say of us. To as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God. Once this happens, once this comes into me, and once I really fall into Christ, then everything changes. That old man that I was becomes a new creation. And the new creation is different. The new creation is the Son of God. When I was a young man, I was very shy and I was very fearful. I was a small person. I mean, I was a skinny little kid. Everybody would pat me. I was just a little guy. Even when I went into the Navy, I was like 122 pounds. I mean, I was just a little rail of a guy. And I was going to go out and confront the world. Fortunately for me, though, a few years earlier, I had become a Christian. And that little fearful guy disappeared. And instead, there was a guy who had the boldness and the courage of Jesus Christ. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. But it wasn't until I find myself in Christ that my mind changed. And let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. Was Christ a fearful person? No. He knew over and over, John says to us, he knew who he was, he knew where he came from, he knew where he was going, and he did this. Knowing everything, knowing that he came from God and that he was going to God, is how John prefaced the fact that Jesus set aside his robes and washed the disciples' feet. Knowing all that was about to happen to him, Jesus stood forth and said, whom do you seek? When he was being arrested there in the garden. Well knowing what was about to happen to him, Jesus Christ had no fear. Therefore, in us, I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me, becomes the new thought. We have a new outlook. There's a new standing before God. There's a new relationship to God that I have that I didn't have before. Before, God was somebody way out there. You know, it's kind of hard to get to know God because he's invisible. It's kind of hard to get to know God because to you and I, God is somebody who is way out there in space somewhere. And we're way over here. And it was hard for people to understand him. But you know how I got to know God? I got to know God through his son. Because in this book is recorded the life of Jesus Christ, not the life of the Father. I know very little about the Father, except for a couple of passages in Revelation where I see him sitting high and lifted up on his throne. And a couple of times even in the Gospels where he spoke from heaven and said, "This is my beloved Son, hear ye him." Three times he speaks in the Gospel of John. That's all I know of the Father, is that he is a heavenly voice. How can you know a person who is nothing more than a heavenly voice? You can't. So how then is God going to get me to know him? Easy. He has to join himself into this world and become the God-man. And by getting to know Jesus Christ, who is, Jesus said, "If you saw me, you have seen the Father." To know me is to know the Father, for my Father and I are one. As I got to know the Son, Jesus Christ, I have begun to know the Father as well. Because they're the same. They have the same heart, the same thought, the same desire, the same love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. But the love of Christ took him to the cross. The love of Jesus Christ allowed him to die and shed his blood for you and for me. And so we have this new creation, this new relationship with God, this new way of life. My life is not my own, but I have been bought with a price. You know, this new life. Take, for example, I work in a hospital. Number one rule in hospital work is wash your hands. But you ever study the futility of washing your hands? We wash our hands, and you know what the process of washing your hands actually makes it worse? It spreads that bacteria, whatever may be in your hand, it swims it all over your hands. It's everywhere now. We wash and we wash and we think we're cleaning it off, and in reality, when you study it, you're making it worse. So we wash our hands with alcohol. Guess what? It doesn't do a whole lot. Still there. All you did was spread the bacteria around, get it to places where it used to not be. That's all. That's why when you go into surgery, they got to put on those gloves. Because your hands are still just as nasty as they were before. That same bacteria is still there, only just a little bit worse. So you and I think, if I could just clean myself up, if I could just wash. Doesn't work that way. All you can do is spread the sin to places it wasn't before. That's why you have to be a new creation. That's why you have to be found in Christ. Because there is no washing yourself up. There's no making yourself clean. So this new Christ, I'm new to him. I discovered Jesus Christ. I discovered the Father. I have a new relationship with him. I know him a little bit better. I have this new life that's within me. I've got new purposes and new reasons. When I was a young man, I had no purpose and reason. I was a son of an alcoholic, probably destined to become an alcoholic myself. That was my lot in life. Just another reservation Indian who would follow the path and end up the same as all the reservation Indians did. A drunkard beating his wife and kids. That was my destiny. Suddenly I become a new creation in Christ. And the old is gone, passed away. The old man buried with all of his deeds, off he went. And suddenly there sprang within me a new purpose in life. The purpose wasn't me. The purpose now became Jesus Christ. My life became centered on something completely different. It became centered on him, bringing honor and glory to him. When I chose my wife, I chose a woman who knew Jesus Christ, who was as willing to serve him as I was. Why? Because everything had changed. Christ had become the central theme. So I wasn't just looking for any old girl. I was looking for a girl who would serve Jesus Christ. Everything changed. The old had passed away. And now the new was there. This new life which began in me, which will never cease. This new eternal life that God placed within me. See, that's why I can't die. I'm just living in this existence, but I have begun my eternal journey, and this journey will never end. I'll just walk someday and keep right on walking. You won't see me anymore. You say, oh, look at the poor old guy. He's laying down right there. That ain't me. I'll be a young, good-looking guy looking down that old beat-up body. Say, wow, that's what I was stuck in? How much did God hate me that he gave me that old carcass to live in? Why? Because I'm new. My kids were there when their grandmother became new. She began her walk a long time ago with God. But my children were present when she took on the new life. And every one of them knew. They could see the door, the gate opening. And they knew she wasn't going off into death. They knew she was going off into life. When she breathed and released her spirit continued living and lives to this very day. They could all sense the opening of the new. This new life with new aims, new purposes, new goals. And really, in our newness, everything changes. The whole universe becomes new to us because the heaven declares his glory. The stars remind me of him. Everything I look at now, I see fingerprints of my Father throughout all of creation. I look at the flowers and I see the beauty of them. And it makes me wonder how beautiful heaven must be if this could be so beautiful. I see the strength of the ocean. I see the power of those waves. And I begin to understand just a little bit that, wow, how powerful God must be. That ship that I was on, over 500 feet long, more than 75 feet wide, and more than 75 feet tall, huge, massive thing. And yet on those waves, it was just tossed like nothing. On that ship, I was insignificant. That ship, the ocean was less insignificant than I was on that ship. And yet God holds it all in the palm of his hand. So in me, Christ in me, and I in him. See, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in you changes everything. Because God is so huge, Christ is so massive, that he changes everything about us. Gives us a new way of looking at everything. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. It's revolutionary. It's fundamentally changing. Jesus meets that demoniac, the crazy guy who was tearing apart the chains and fetters, the guy who was living out there in the graveyard. He meets Jesus, and what are we told? The city came out, and they saw that he was in his right mind. And it scared them. But the man wanted to follow Jesus. And Jesus said, no, you can't follow me now. I want you to go back to your city and tell them what God has done for you. And so we read the next verse that he went back to his hometown and told people everything that Jesus had done for him. He knew who God was. Because he told everybody what Jesus had done. When Jesus said, go home and tell everybody what God has done for you. He knew that Jesus was God. And he published it abroad, everything that Jesus had done for him. No longer out there in the grave, but back home with his wife and his kids. No longer tearing apart the chains, but now sharing with people that his chains had been torn off by Jesus Christ. Our purpose, the world we look at, not for its riches, not for its fame, not for its gold, but for its glory that it could bring to our Father if we used it properly. Because we're a new creation. Not something that I have created. I am not like Dr. Frankenstein. I have no ability to create anything. Remember when Dr. Frankenstein tried to create? What did he create? The monster. You and I try to create, guess what we create? A monster. Man has tried through the years to create a new religion, and every single religion has become a monster. Before the invention of gunpowder, before the invention of the bullet, before the invention of the gun, when men went to war, they learned to arm themselves. They would place a little bit of armor. First it was leather, then finally it was copper, then bronze, then finally iron. And they began to clad themselves in steel. And although this was designed to save their life, it got so heavy and so cumbersome that as those knights would ride off on their horse, if they should be knocked off their horse, the weight of that metal would pin them to the ground. And would eventually take their life if somebody did not come by and rescue them from their own armor. And that's what religion has become. Religion, what was designed to save some man's life, became such a heavy burden that it knocks him down and doesn't give him the ability to get back up. Jesus is the antithesis to all of that. See, religion is, if I get good enough, I can get to the Father. Jesus said, you'll never get good enough. Let me take you to the Father. Jesus Christ has done all that ever needs to be done to get you to heaven. You cannot get there on your own, plain and simple. I, Jesus said, am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. There is no other way. No man comes unto the Father but by me. There is one name given under heaven by where you must be saved. Jesus Christ the righteous. Over and over again, we are told that there's nothing we can do. We are told that in this life, we have so little. We are told that we must be in Christ. We are told here that there's a new creation within. We have been told about the new creation without. This is the way of the new creation. The new creation begins by us understanding that we are sinners and need a Savior. Our understanding that Jesus Christ is that Savior, understand that we must ask for salvation. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You can't get there on your own. There is none righteous. You can't even help somebody get there because there's none righteous. I can't help you because I'm as lost as you are unless Jesus finds you as he found me. And once he finds you, he delivers you. Father, forgive them, he would say. They know not what they do. Nothing I can do for myself. It's appointed unto man once to die, and after this, the judgment. Period. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God, eternal life through the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord. That becomes our new central thought. And since that's our new central thought and our new basis is that it's not me. It's all him. In my salvation, none of it is me. It's all him. Therefore, in my life, none of it is me. It's all him. And all my outlooks, all my desires, all my wants are based on, as Paul said, that idea. In him. That's got to become our new thought. We have to constantly remind ourselves that we are in him. And if we are in him, what does that change in us? Everything. Because if you're in him, then you're a new creation. You're not a new creation outside of him. That's why so many Christian people never change. They never get in him. They never open their Bible. They never read their gospel. They don't know anything about Jesus. Oh, they're lucky if they know he was born in Bethlehem because they celebrate Christmas. If it weren't for old little town of Bethlehem, how still thee sleep, they wouldn't even know that's where he was born. They wouldn't know he grew up in Nazareth. They wouldn't know he died for their sins. He wouldn't know that he prayed for you. They wouldn't know that he interceded on your behalf, that all of John chapter 17 is all about you. They don't know that because they never read it. So they have difficulty being in Christ. Therefore, most Christian people, most, quote, Christian people, have no change of life because they don't even know him. And if the new creation takes place in him, that's why for so many people the new creation never takes place. That's why there's no change. They're the same before and after. There's no difference. Because the difference only takes place in Him.